So folks, good morning. And I want to certainly welcome you and thank you for joining us as we come together to honor Russell. Long connection between the Freitag family and the Chapman's family, of which I would like to say I'm grateful and honored that you've asked me to begin the service today. Under difficult circumstances, the week of a holiday, the pandemic, all of you have come today to help celebrate and remember. And because Russell knew the importance of a eulogy, and he offered many good eulogies during his lifetime, this service shall be comprised of some religion, but mostly personal tributes. And if you ever heard Russell deliver a eulogy at a funeral, you recognized how important that was to him. So I thank you again. And without further ado, I'm pleased to introduce Russell's longtime friend, Larry Morrison, who happens to be a retired Episcopal minister, who will begin the service. Larry.
I also want to give thanks to the family for inviting me and welcoming me in the spirit of Russ Chappie, as I must say, was the most welcoming person, one of the most welcoming persons I knew in life. I first knew Russell at Bank Street School in kindergarten, and it might come as no surprise that I don't remember much about kindergarten. Russ and I shared notes, and he didn't remember much about it either. So I remember not liking to take a nap. And I was, like most little boys, squirmy and wanting action rather than thought and sleep. But there we were. And then we transferred up to Pearl Street School in first grade. And I left there in the middle of the year and went out to Stove Creek School, or Stove Creek if you want. And didn't come back until the third grade. And so we were together from the middle of the third grade on. I was away for 2 years through high school, or through grade school rather, Pearl Street, and then junior high, high school. I went away to the Navy and other places for years. And then it was a time when we came back, and I started coming to the reunions every 5 years. The first reunion, I was kind of worried about things. Because I didn't know many of the people. I hadn't been around them a lot. And how are they going to receive us? I got married by that time. We were together, brought my wife to the reunion, high school reunion. And Beth and Russ were dancing in the middle of the floor. And Russ took one look at me and said, "Larry, boy, gave me a shot on the arm," and immediately I felt welcome in the school. Russ was that kind of a person. After years, he was my friend. We had played together in grade school, and Russ, the games that we played at that time, marbles and Mumbly Peg. I bet nobody remembers Mumbly Peg. Well, you had to have a pen knife, and you flipped it different ways, and it stuck in the ground. And we played together, the yo-yo. Who plays yo-yos anymore? But Russ was always so good at it. He flipped that marble, and it would go and knock all the other marbles away. He was that kind of guy. And But through it all, he never made us, the rest of us, feel bad. If we weren't good at it, he was patient. He had a personal side to him. He liked being with friends. And he had friends who were not athletic, not great ball players. He didn't mock them. He received them. And I'm grateful for that. I'm grateful for his friendship. If I had to characterize Russ, and I'm not trying to get his whole life into this small talk, just one word, though, and that is steadfast. Steadfast. You might say, well, what does steadfast mean? Well, we know what steady means, right? Somebody that's reliable, somebody who's there. Stead is a place. When we say instead, that means basically in place. I go here instead of there. I like this instead of that. Stead means, yeah, a place. Fast means like fasten. And steadfast means to stay with something, stick with it through thick and thin. That's the way I like to think of Russ. He had a friend, he stuck with you. He stuck fast, he was fastened to you. Russ and Bev, I think I learned this morning, 1962. You got married?
Yeah.
1962. A faithful husband. And then a faithful father. A steadfast father and grandfather. A person you could rely on. 1959, when he graduated from high school, he went to work for the bank. And he worked steadfastly. He stayed at that same job. I can't tell you how many jobs I've had. And that seems to be the thing today. Russ, not for Russ. Kind of employee you'd like to have. And he was faithful in his community, helping the young people, sports, and so the rest of you are going to say much more than I know. I want to say that Russell has been a faithful friend, a steadfast friend to me for some 74 years. And I am blessed to have known him. His memory will go with me as long as I'm here on this earth. I've shared stories of Russ with family and friends, and I'll continue to do that. And he will not be forgotten. What next for Russ? And I would be remiss if I didn't say I also talked about the Lord Jesus Christ and the resurrection, that I don't believe that this is the end. Russell. Jesus rose from the dead, ascended into heaven, sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And through him, as he said himself, I am the resurrection and the life. I am the resurrection and the life. There will be a life after. I think that Russ, in his heart, he believed that God hath raised him, that is Jesus, from the dead. He's a great person, and Russ was a great personality, a great friend to all. And now he's in the hands of a father, and may God bless and keep him there in the Father's hand. Let us pray. Father, we thank thee for the life of Russell Chappius, for the influence that he has over the lives of the people in this room and far beyond it. Bless that memory and keep us hopeful for the future and keep us with fond memories of the past. We pray this in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Thank you, Larry. As a friend and as pastor, those words. Anybody that knew Russ knew that he was devoted to sports, devoted to his community. He was dedicated to his work at F&M Bank, where he rose from very humble beginnings to become a senior vice president. No one probably knew him better than his wife, Bev, and she has a few things she would like to share, really in Russ's own words. Bev?
Thank you. I'm not going to look at anybody except this microphone so I can get through this. This was not planned for me to say anything at all. And this morning I was going through some of Russell's papers and I found this paper that he handwrote that says Russell Chappius Sr. Advice. And I know that Kenny, do you have his written copy? No, no, this is the copy. You know why? Because it's late. 1 minute. So I found this that he had written his hands, and you're going to hear people speak of Russell. And I read this over, and it just, to me, it is exactly how he lived his life. And if you weren't really close to him, you might get a better understanding of him. Okay, face your fears. Not everything that is faced can be changed, but nothing can be changed until it is faced. Don't let people define you. No one can make you feel inferior without your consent. Advice for business and life. Build a bridge, not a barrier. Make a friend, not a fuss. Find a cause, not a critic. Seek a solution, not a standoff. Make the best of things. Things turn out best for people who make the best of the way things turn out. The gift of a day. Every morning you are handed 24 hours. They are one of the few things in this world that you can get free of charge. If you had all the money in the world, you couldn't buy an extra hour. What will you do with this priceless treasure? Remember, you must use it as it is given only once. Once wasted, you cannot get it back. Life is what it is. life is not the way we supposed it to be. It's the way it is. The way you cope with this is what makes the difference. Be who you are. Do not be anything but what you are, and try to be that perfectly. Forget past misfortunes. Reflect upon your present blessings, of which everyone has plenty. Not on your past misfortunes, of which we all have some. Lastly, don't succeed at doing nothing. If you have tried to do something and failed, you are vastly better off than if you had tried to do nothing and succeeded.
Thank you, Bev. And Russell's own words.
Russell's own words.
Great words to live by, for sure. And now I'm going to ask young Dr. Russell if you'll come forward, please, with some of your comments.
I would like to say that it is truly an honor to share my papa's name. And to be his grandson. I'm very thankful I got the opportunity to tell him that before he passed. I'm also very thankful for all the memories over the past 27 years of my life. I will miss the sports room, and I asked to see it almost every time I went over. It's the most incredible thing I've ever seen, I think.
Yeah.
I will miss all the ice cream sundaes, the 1,000 Santas at Christmas time, and our many conversations. I hope that one day I'm a papa and I can be what he was to me, and that was kind, gentle, and supportive. I want to mention that I had the pleasure of meeting many of his friends and people that worked for him or knew him over these past 5 months that I've been working locally, and I really enjoy hearing all the stories and all the good things they have to say about him. And it's nothing but good things that they have to say about him. I just always have gotten the impression from these people that he's very loved and respected in this community, and he will be very missed in this community. And that just makes me so happy and proud. I love you, Papa, and you'll always be one of my heroes. May you rest in peace.
Thank you, Russ. After those two, I feel sorry for all that have to follow. But I know you'll do your best. And I know someone who's up to the challenge is granddaughter Francesca. Jessica, if you'll come forward.
So I want to start off by saying that I specifically requested to go after Russell, and I now regret that. just for the record, I am an actor, not a speaker. but thank you guys for being here. Thanks everyone for coming, whether you were here in person or virtually. It's a hard time, and so your presence, however you're choosing to engage, is equally important, and we appreciate it. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Francesca. I am my grandfather's first and oldest grandchild, and I'm sister to Russell, Nicholas, and Melina Chappius. We are so lucky, my siblings and I, to have had all of our grandparents for so long. My pop-up was a part of my life for 29 long years. He was a positive, consistent role model, caregiver, and companion to me from the time I was born until the last few weeks of his life. When I saw him a couple of weeks ago, we talked about very little. It was hard to see him sit so still. I loved seeing him bustle around the house when we came over. He would give us the grand tour of the snacks and the ice creams, and he would serve it to us with such care and grandiosity. One thing he kept saying each day I was visiting him was how proud he was of me and of all my siblings, and what good kids we are. There was a time I thought I was a real disappointment to him, since I chose to be in the summer musical over doing baseball. Until it became customary for him and Grammy to come to Saturday Mass whenever I was singing. And I assure you, it wasn't for the service. Luckily, my brothers went on to play sports, so he got to enjoy many opportunities to watch baseball and later watch my brothers run for Cumberland Regional. My sister, however, went on to sing and perform like me, and he was just as thrilled. To him, it didn't matter if we were on stage for 10 minutes or benched the entire game, which I have been. He came to every single thing. And I mean every concert, every presentation, every show, every graduation and award ceremony, and of course, every sports game. I'm gonna miss having him in the audience. My favorite thing about my pop-up was his passion for the details. And as kids, we would beg him to go to the sports room, as Russell mentioned. And my favorite game to play was, I would point at random things and I would ask for the story. And he would always know what day he went and or how long he waited or some absurd detail about the weather. So, you know, he would just know every single thing about how he got a signature or how he got the seat from the stadium. And I didn't really care about sports or athletes or anything. I really enjoyed watching him enjoy remembering all of those details. At Christmas, he loved watching us open gifts, being something that he didn't get to enjoy as a kid, and he loved to spoil us. It's not quite Christmas for me until I go over and see the house filled with Santees, as he used to say. I'm not sure if he enjoyed putting them up more than he enjoyed having them out. Oh my God, he loved to eat, right? We used to have very heated discussions about what was permissible to put on a hot dog. Just so you're aware, ketchup is unacceptable. He always had certain treats he loved that my mom made, and he kept telling me in the hospital how much he loved my grandma Pachoni's lasagna. I'm sure he has a favorite dish with just about everyone. No other man alive appreciated a good meal quite like my grandfather. My papa told me the last few days of his life how proud he was of me, but I am the one who feels proud. Proud to know a man who lived and loved so fully and so unapologetically. He brought joy and gratitude everywhere he went. He never let a moment pass without being a part of it. He was an exceptional athlete, collector, and foodie. But more than that, he was a loving friend, father, husband, and the best papa. He will be greatly missed, but not forgotten.
Jessica, thank you. Beautiful thoughts and memories of a humble and kind man. Friends, Jerry, where are you, Jerry Daniels? Come on down.
I have to say, Ken, it's not Jerry, it's Hoppy.
Right.
Forever and always will be Hoppy.
Thank you very much. It's very warm and touching that I was able to be here today. And I try to remember Russ, the best friend I've ever had in my lifetime. Russ and I met first in junior high school. When I met him, he was such a wonderful person and permitted him to become close friends with me. This goes back to the years 1954, 1954, 1955, somewhere in that time frame. And then he coined that nickname, Hoppy, when we were in gym class. Everybody was doing straddle hops except for me. I was going up and down. After that, we actually became blood brothers. If anyone knows how you do that, you stick your finger, and we put our fingers together. So we are actually true blood brothers. Throughout those high school years, we went to Rudy Carnegie Dancing School, and usually that was on Friday evening, and we had fun there. A lot of people went there to learn to dance, but I went there for the soda and the pretzels. After we left dancing school that evening, we usually went out to a small sub shop, and we played pinball machines. It was always so much fun. Always enjoyed Friday evenings. And then Russ was so engaged in sports. I would visit him at times when he was playing. And I actually gave him the nickname of Babe. Babe. A reference to Babe Ruth. Because he was an exceptional athletic. After graduating from high school, he went right to work, Farmers and Merchants Bank over here on Broad Street. I always remember when I went to make deposits. That time I was working, and I would stop there, and it was always a pleasure to see him at the teller's cage and speak to him. And he was very masterful in his duties at the bank. And then he became senior vice president. He was always very caring and helpful, not only to the customers, but to the employees as well. Obviously, Russ was an advocated sports fan ever since he was young. I know he played sports and did that for many years. He was not only a good player, but he valued the working relationship with all the friends and his teammates. It was great that he was honored by the Sports Museum for his contribution and dedication to maintain the purpose of the sport. He collected a lot of sports memorabilia, which I always considered was a museum by itself. Russell was a very decent and respectful man. He was always thoughtful of others, based upon the golden rule: do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Russ supported his sons, Russell and Scott, very much. Russ has supported consideration for everyone. He was very kind, considerate, caring, and respectful for everyone, regardless of who they were. I have been truly fortunate to have known Russell, and he has been the best friend in my life. He has always been a role model to me. He will be surely missed by all members of the Chappius family and all of his many friends. May he rest in peace. Thank you.
Thanks, Hobby. We'll remember you that way for sure. Great words. And now someone who has a lot of trouble speaking in public. I'd like to ask one of my favorite people, John Passero, to come forward, please, John.
Thank you. Buddy, I know that I did not wear a jersey of a local or Philadelphia team today. Instead, I decided to wear a jersey I obtained at a show that we went to together and that you admire. Beverly, Russell's family and friends, I am sure that what I say about Russell will be echoed by a number of people here today. It is an honor and privilege to say a few words about Russell, one of the most generous, kindest, nicest, and loving persons I have ever met, and whom we will all miss tremendously. Mitch Albom wrote a best-selling book, The Five People You Meet in Heaven, which is a novel about a character named Eddie, who died and went to heaven where he encountered five people who had a significant impact on him while he was alive. If the book were written about Russell's life, it could be titled Special People You Meet on Earth. Its theme would be centered about a person who had a profound positive influence on your life and whom you hope to meet again in heaven after your death. All of us could talk for hours about Russell's virtues, which are many, but I will focus on the following few traits that Russell possessed in abundance and their effect on our relationship. Sportsmanship, determination, love of friends and family, and class and dignity. I first met Russell about 65 years ago when we played baseball as a teenager, and then after that when we played softball in the Industrial League. Our sports careers overlapped a few years until I had to stop playing because of work commitments. We were never teammates, but the player that I had the utmost respect for was Mr. Left Fielder, Russell Chapkus. He played left field flawlessly and was an excellent hitter as well. He had an extraordinary baseball IQ. He rarely made a blunder while playing. Our teams were fairly evenly matched, but with Russell, you could see the competitive juices flow as he always tried to do his very best to rally his team to victory. However, win or lose, he was a model citizen in defeat as well, which very rarely occurred. Russell was an avid sportsman who was always graceful, whether in victory or in defeat. Russell had surplus determination during his lifetime. He possessed several collections, including a sports memorabilia collection that was second to none. If there was a Richie Ashburn item he desired, Russell would go to great lengths to obtain it so he could add it to his own private Ashburn alley. He would wait in long lines for an autograph or other item that he cherished. Many of us who were his friends were so fortunate to enjoy his collection that he was proud to display and share with us. We were always lucky to have gone with him to various sports cards or memorabilia shows or functions. What wonderful memories Russ gave to us who are sports enthusiasts. But the very best part of all these events and activities was that we were enjoying them with our friend Russell. His determination was especially evident during the last few years of his life, where he fought a long and courageous battle with cancer. Many of his friends, including myself, were in his company where he barely could have enough energy to cope with pain and anguish, but he tried valiantly.
I guess we got to put the car back on because I can't.
Pushing the pain aside.
I can't hear it.
One of the biggest pleasures of my life will always be witnessing him approximately a year and a half ago during a period when I was able to play golf with his friends and go to sports shows for a few hours. His fortitude and spirit was contagious. The highlight that I will never forget is that he shot his age on a golf course, an accomplishment that is remarkable and outstanding even for someone who is completely healthy. Even though he knew death was coming and he lost his battle with cancer, his determination in coping in the last several years is unforgettable. Hopefully, he is now in a better place where
he'll
enjoy his company again someday.
It doesn't look overly crowded, does it?
In every venture of his life, Russell made. He was beloved, importantly, all walks of life. He was a valued member of the board of the All Sport Museum of Southern New Jersey, and his participation in many other enterprises was always met with acclaim. The days of my life occurred when my grandson and Russell's grandson were in high school. Russell and I took our grandsons to lunch and then to lunch with several other people who I am honored to count as very close friends, with his uncanny and natural ability to make everyone feel at home. The competition is fierce among those of us in these days, but in those years, all of us have developed a bond of Frank Russell, who was loved and respected by all of us. Until a couple years ago, I was able to perform wedding ceremonies. I was blessed to have performed several. So proud of his family members, his many friends, and was so appreciative of everything someone did for him or his family. No matter how much he cherished his friends, the love of his life was Bev, his wife of 58 years and soulmate for 65 years. He idolized Beverly and showed the love for her in so many ways. He was so generous to her and the rest of his family. Often when we would go to a sports show, we would stop at Five Guys on the way back, and Russell always made a point of not forgetting to order a burger to take home to bed. In this regard, I want to single out Kevin Dannon, who unselfishly drove Russell to many of those events at Earl Gandy and several others, and thank them for the great times we had on the days we attended those shows with Russell. All of us who have been involved with Russell through work, sports, fantasy leagues, the All Sports Museum, or any other endeavor that Russell was involved with have benefited greatly from our relationship with him. In the 65 years that I've known Russell, I have never heard him utter a negative word about anyone or act with anger towards anyone. He has always been an absolute gentleman who carried himself with class and dignity. I am proud to be able to share with you my memories of Russell. I wish that all of our mutual friends had that opportunity as well, because he was one of the best persons I've ever had the pleasure to meet. We are all better for having known him. Someday, I hope all of us have the opportunity to meet him in heaven. In the meantime, my friend Russell, may God bless you, and may you rest in peace until we meet again.
Much appreciation, Johnny. Thank you. So there's the family that you have, the friends that you have, and then there's the family that you marry into. So a privilege for daughter-in-law Cindy, along with Scott Jr., who will come and share.
Matthew 5:4, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted.
Let's pray. Dear God, our Heavenly Father, thank you for the gift of Russell's life. We are grateful for the time that we had with him and the incredible impact that he has had on all of our lives. Please help us to celebrate his life and focus on all the beautiful memories that we've shared with him, instead of the mourning and loss that has left with him gone. Please wrap your arms around Bev in her time of grief. Let her feel your presence and comfort. Surround her in your love. Give Russ's family and friends the strength to heal, to keep his memory and dedication to his family for generations to come. We give thanks in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Cindy and Scott, that verse of scripture. We are blessed because we come together today to honor a friend and family member. So, Bob Zimmerman's a longtime friend of the Chappius family and fellow supporter of the South Jersey Hall of Fame. Bob, you can come forward to offer some comments, please.
Scott, Cindy, us, and all the grandkids, how proud he was and loved you guys so much. And Bev, you were simply the love of his life. I got to know Russ through my older brother when they were in high school, and made an impression on me then. And he was one of the guys, the older guys, that let me play ball with him. And that friendship started when he went to work and I was in college, and the Army And when I got out of the Army in 1970 in January, I went to work at the Farmers Merchants Bank for 3 years, but that January, Russ got me into playing basketball with his team, and we played only several hundred games together. And then come springtime, he got me to play on the Farmers and Merchants Fast Pitch softball team. And he was so proud of that team. We played together for well over 1,000 games together, many years. And as he said at our manager, Yuri's eulogy, that team over 30 years or so won around 1,200 games and lost less than 100. Sorry, Bruce. And John. He's very successful. What made the team very successful were a bunch of people like Russ, that we cared for each other. We were teammates, our families were friends, and we cared and played hard together. He was the most dedicated man I've known to his family, to his sports museum, and to his friends. When he had his accident a number of years ago, fell off his ladder, my office was in Elmer, and he was in the Elmer Hospital, and I would stop and see him, but the first time I walked in, I thought, oh, this is not good. And he looked up and smiled, and the first thing out of my mouth was, what the hell did you do? And every day I would stop and see him at lunchtime and then after work before I went home. And about a year and a half or so year later, I happened to fall off a ladder, ended up in the hospital. And the next day, somebody comes peeking around into the room, looks at me and says, what the hell did you do? I said, well, Russ, you're my hero. I want to be like you. He said, well, that's not too bright. And I said, I found out one thing. Neither of us can fly. But it's all good memories with Russ. The years we played ball together, the years after playing ball together, how my family and his family, we were a part of each other's families. And the friendships meant so much. There's one thing that I did not hear mentioned today. You look around the room, how many people in your lives do you know that you can't say a bad thing about them? That man is the only person that I knew you could not say one bad word about him. And I am truly honored and was blessed to be able to call him my friend and the whole Chappies family as part of our family and friends. We're going to miss you, Russ. And I'll tell you what, if there's softball in heaven, they got a hell in left field. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. And next, I'd like to call on Rich Peel, colleague, golfer, and speaker extraordinaire.
Here comes Streaker. Yeah. So, I brought props. But following all this, really, after everything that I've written down, I'm just going to say, John Cassaro, ditto. Russ, my friend, it is a sad day, but it is also a good day that we get to spend with you and the friends and the family that you brought together. I have notes in here. I've gone over things to try and help me get through a little bit of a speech. I was going to stand up here and say, four, you better be sitting down for this and not out playing golf. That comes later. But my initial contact with the Chappius family, I believe, goes back to working with Russ as a roofer. And we had some fun then. A year later, I was sitting at Russ's desk at Farmers and Merchants looking for a new job because I was not happy where I was at. I hadn't even filled out an application. And he sat there and said, the job is yours if you want it, and we'll take care of the application and stuff later. Signed me up. 2 weeks later, I was at Farmers and Merchants. Lasted 14 years, but he was always there. We shared ball games, golf, good times, the Christmas parties, watching Russ and Bev dance around the floor at the DuPont. Like I said, the softball games, I always knew who Russ was from the F&M Bank team. I never got to see Russ play. The one time I was finally looking forward to it, they were supposed to play a softball game at the Bridgeton tournament. And I get there, it's an overcast day. The game that's being played goes extra innings. And by the time they're done, it is raining like you wouldn't believe. Russ's game didn't get played that night and never got to see the man play softball. But I knew who he was, the team, Charlie Johnson, Jack Johnson, Jordan. Our golf trips. We're playing golf locally. Go hands it. Holly Hills. Don't laugh. Myrtle Beach. I don't have any hats from Virginia Beach, but Ocean City, Maryland. But one of the best things we all know about Russ is his love for Santa. I have had this hat longer than I've known Russ, but it was always something I brought out at Christmas time. I know Russ being up in heaven, he's got a great foursome or even a fivesome. The golf that we played with Harry, Dan, Walter Gavigan. The senior golf tournaments that we went to over in Pennsylvania. And the autographs that we got, the time that we did spend together. It was nice to become part of Russell's life. I never expected anything like that in my life, but Russell was a true friend. Back to Farmers and Merchants and remaining friends until now, the love of Santa. The one thing I could always rely on from Russ was whenever I saw him at the store, he always had a hug and a kiss for me. Step offline, people look at us funny, but my eyes are a little blurry here, I'm sorry. To your family, you guys, Russ, Scotty, from experience, you're going to experience a pain like you've never felt, I'm sure, but there will be good times. It is something that will last a lifetime with you. It's okay to laugh. You grieve when you want, how you want, but don't let anybody tell you that you can't. And that it's time to stop. You had a great father, great role model, the way you guys expressed your love for him on Facebook. You know, just seeing those posts from all of you, Bev. What can I say? It's always a pleasure to see you. So, the one last thing I do remember about Russ, once again, back to Farmers and Merchants, like somebody did mention how we love to eat. going down in the basement and watched Manny the large big John pizza by himself.
He wanted a dome box.
Yeah. He just sat there and he's eating and he's talking to his company and they were having a good time. Russell, it's been an honor to be called your friend. It's an honor to be here and celebrate your life. You rest easy, my friend. And we'll catch you up there and play some golf.
Thank you, Rich. Very nicely stated. Those memories that we shared about the golf course from a few days ago, too. Next, I would call on another colleague and longtime friend, and that is Steve Paul. Steve.
Seem I'm preaching to the choir about friendship. It's going to be hard for me to get through this. Russell is every man, every woman's friend. Russell could eulogize. And you say, and by the way, Jenny, I'm not going to be sure. My father told me yesterday, keep it light, keep it airy. He's 101 years old.
Wow.
He only knows Russell from what Judy and I have told him. He's met Russell several times. Met a lot of people. He's met no one like Russell. He knows Russell from us as a conduit, what we tell him about Russell. I told him Russell was very ill. I told him Russell had passed away. He immediately started to pray for Russell. Okay. And he is not a very religious man. But he prayed. When he was done, he said, how old was Russell? I said, Russell was 79. He said, I was so young. So it's a terrible loss, and I don't have to go into the friendship because we were all friends, and he was a great friend. And I was much more than a friend in that Russell was my mentor. I had two mentors, Russell and John Catalina Sr., two different personalities. They gave so generously to teach me, because I'm almost unteachable. And they added up to two-thirds of my knowledge in banking and in work. And I appreciated work. And they were tremendous workers, and they were very generous with their time. Russell later in life became the champion. Became one of my heroes. I had four bad heroes. And I told him he was one of them. He was the only non-family hero I had. But I've been around Russell a lot of times. I gravitated toward, you know, good athletes, jocks. They had that in common. You know, I was not a good jock. He was. I made good friends in college if they were good people. It was easy to become their friend in basketball. I have no ability in baseball, none whatsoever, not in softball. I love playing soccer and basketball and a lot of other sports, golf. I was not particularly good. But in basketball, I realized people like Russell, if you want to become really good friends, and they're a scorer and they're real tall, let's say, you get the ball to them. You you get the ball to them all the time. Okay? And they're going to love you. You're going to let them score it. You're going to pass to them. And they're going to come up to you at some point. He did not say this, but in college, it will come. You remind me of my kid brother. Get the ball to them. They will love you. There will be a friendship there. But when you let somebody mentor you, you joined at the hip, you do the same job, you do much more. Russell had to do 200% of work. I had to do 150. It was not a competition. We were doing different jobs. He taught me his job. John Catalano taught me his job. I had to learn my own job, be my own person. But I drew on that experience, the experience of drawing all this energy from these two men. And from Russell, I drew friendship too, as well. Later in life, we became very socially involved with Beverly, Chris and Judy, my wife. And it led to a lot of good times. And then you saw him in a different light. But I can tell you, I do so much energy. That's what I always do. I align myself with people that are doers, that do great things. Supermen, superwomen. And I draw energy from them. That's how I do it. But I can never pay them back, in Russell's case. What I tried to do was, how could I help him most? Not just doing my job so that he would have success or I would have success. But how could I do my job for him? How could I reach him? And so this is what I always did to everybody, family members or whatever. I would make fun of them, but I would also make fun of myself. Okay? I would keep playing Harry and try to entertain them. And Russell comes from a family of entertainers, of artistic people. But there's a difference here in that Russell never had to apologize to anyone. Never in my presence. Okay? He never had to. He never had to say he was sorry. He was such a good person. He was unbelievable. Such a generous person. So there was an attraction there. Because as good as Russell is, I'm a very bad person. Okay? I would tell him, a very bad person. He wouldn't believe that. So that's how I see myself. Bad person. He said, you're not a bad person. You're religious. You and Judy are religious. And I said, I'm the biggest sinner you're going to see today. That doesn't cut it. So, but there was an attraction there. As good as he was, I was bad. My own heart. But I was getting better. And he wanted me to be better and to get better. And for him, I wanted to get better. And in a friendship, you draw that energy. He makes you want to be a better friend. So I drew from that over the years. And I got slightly better. I'm not here for people. But I am a bad actor. And Rusty can tell you, at his bachelor party, when I get nervous, I do some bad things. Some very funny things to lighten the moment. You know, not say what they are. So, Russell allowed me to be his mutt. And he was my Jeff. So we were mutt and Jeff. And I would try to get him to laugh constantly. But I would do this with most everybody at the expense of other people, I might add. But it started, and I want to share a couple of remembrances. It started with, I walked up in his office one day to discuss something. And he knew I was trying to be funny all the time. But it's like, oh, you're looking better today. You look pretty good. You lost some weight? He can. I'm trying to lose something. When's it going to show? When's it going to show? And he would break up. And you can't do that with everybody, but you could do it with him, because he was a generous and such a nice person. Sam did that, and it's always spontaneous. Walked in about a month later. Yeah. You look pretty good today. You lost some weight. I think it's, no, I haven't been trying. I didn't think so, because it doesn't show. And he laughed. The third time, some months later, he said, I'm not answering. So then what we would do is, Kevin, or John Mossbrooks, would be in the office. So I would walk in and they would talk to him. Am I interrupting? No. I'd say, hey, Kevin, you're looking better. You're looking pretty good. Have you lost some weight? And Kevin would look at me. Well, I would glance at Russell. He would light right up and get ready for it. And I would lower the boom. And I don't think Kevin appreciated it, but Russell would laugh, and he would laugh long. So this can only go on so long, but I would try to find other ways of making him laugh at all times, because that was important in friendship. We had a lot of common interests, work being one of them. Once someone mentors you, you're going to have to be their friend. Sports, basketball, his collection, unbelievable collection that he had. He was so, so proud of that. It was mind-blowing and mind-bending at the same time. I could not spend much time in there because it was overwhelming. But I know that it was his pride and joy. He had many jobs. He would run out of the bank to play ball. He would run out of the bank to help the family, to help Bev, be with them. The early years, especially, he would run out of the bank to follow everybody. They were doing. He would run out of the bank to work in his yard. He had many, many jobs. And so I would draw energy from all this hard work. If I see somebody that's working that hard, I wouldn't be around. I want to draw that energy. So I looked at ways of trying to impress him. And the best way was humor and to keep it light. I will say this, that I'm going to share. I've never told anybody this. Ross is the only person I've told this to, because I was trying to impress him. He loved sports and he knew everything. He knew much more than me. So I told him one day, Ross, I'm going to tell you something I've never told anybody before. I never have until now. And I said, sit down. I said, you're not going to believe this, but in college, I was shooting basketball with a couple of my friends, just shooting in December and January in the winter. Wasn't working out. And I said, I got into a pickup game, a 3-on-3. These guys asked us to play, these men. We were only about 20, 21. And the three men were Henry Bibby, his brother Mike Bibby, and Don Clendenin. They're all professional athletes. Two baseball, one basketball. Two were brothers. For any context, baseball, see Bobby Zimmerman. Context of basketball, you can see me. Basically, Henry Bibby was a point guard for John Walton, led UCLA teams. His brother Mike Bibby was a starting pitcher and a good relief pitcher for the Pittsburgh Pirates. Don Clendenin was a great first baseman for the Pittsburgh Pirates. So I had that, and I felt I had something that would impress him. So we played that game. It was just a pickup game. They took it very easy on us. So I told him about that. That did impress him, I'm sure, because it was a thrill of a lifetime. And he goes, that was great. Did you get an autograph? Did you get autographs? I said, Russell, you you're missing the point here. They asked us to play the pickup game. We're 20, we're 21. So I said, Russell, in that same period of time, I had personal conversations with Billy Cunningham and his wife, with Dr. Jack Ramsey, coach of the 76ers, coach of St. Joe's Hawks. I would talk to, at parties in Ocean City, I would talk to, I'm dropping a lot of names here, Billy Melchione and his wife, Mac Hugas and his wife. It was through mutual friends, through friendship. And I said, I would talk to these people. I was comfortable doing it. It was in a social setting among friends. And he was impressed. This was the same time. And he goes, yeah, but did you get their autographs? And I said, no, it's not about that. I said, I don't need those autographs. They only have two autographs, Jack Nicklaus and Richard Nixon, through mutual friends. And Jack Nicklaus appeared here in 1966. That would tell you how to get a recall of the guns. Well, this was good for him. He understood, I think. I said, autographs are not important. I can't find those two autographs. I've lost jewelry from my wife. It's in my house somewhere. I've lost my keys. I'm a bad person. So, and I'm a bad actor. So he still didn't get it. So I said, look, I've told you that you're one of my heroes. Okay? You know that. I have 4 or 5 heroes. You're one of them. He said, yeah, I know. And I said, I only have one celebrity in my life. I have all kinds of writing from them. I have their autograph. And you know what, Russell? If I need any other autographs, that celebrity has 5,000 of them. I can go to him for those. But later, the other words I want to share with you that we shared together. We're at his ceremony when they honored him. Kevin Bannon, so you know that. It was a grand evening when they celebrated All Sports, South Jersey All Sports Museum. And they were honoring Russell not that many years ago for his lifetime achievement. It was his big evening, and it was grand, and it was great, and the hall was great, and everybody was having a good time. And we were sitting there, we toured the hall, and everything had been said, and everybody was great. Russell was very happy, and family was very happy. Everybody was very happy. And I was sitting there eating some cake, talking to a couple of people, and they got up. And they left. So I'm still feeding my face, my cake, being a beta guy. And Russell walks over, and from behind, leans over and kisses me on the top of the head. And I said, what was that for? Because, seriously, I look like Dick Cheney. Okay, would you kiss the top of his head? I don't think so. He says, I'm just so happy tonight. I'm just so happy that you're here. And I said, nah, there's something more. He says, no, I'm so happy that my friend is here. And I said, no, there's more. And he said, I'm so happy that all my friends are here. And I said, that's right. I live vicariously through movies. And so I needed to describe Russell in these last year or so. Because people would ask me, well, how's Russell? How's Russell doing? And so I had to come up with something to describe Russell, to describe his essence. I don't have to tell you, you all know what Russell was like. So I would say the people that didn't know him that well, from church, from acquaintance, they wanted to know how he was doing. And I said, listen,
I said, Russell, Chappius, is the toughest guy I know. He's the strongest guy I know. I said, he's hard as a rock. I said, he's doing well. He's doing well. And I wasn't lying, I believe that. He was rugged. And he was facing the wall. So I wanted them to know that he was up to it. He was the toughest guy I ever knew. That did what he did. And they accepted that. But later, as he was getting really ill, I had to come up with something better. So you've all heard of Man for All Seasons. If you haven't, I can describe it to you later. So I coined for Russell that he was a friend for all seasons in my mind to describe him. Because I was comfortable with that, because I think that's what he was for everyone, a friend for all seasons. I know that I'll never forget him. I had words with him that I could share with Judy and eventually with Beth. Last time I saw him in the hospital. Basically, to paraphrase, a man that never had to apologize for anything, a man that never had to be sorry, I was going to tell him that he needed to get on with his life, that he's on out of this, that he had people waiting for him, and he had made them wait too long, and I wanted him to release this book. And it was hard. It was very hard to let go. And I know it was hard for him to let go. But he beat me to it. Right away, he was serenely lying there asleep. I thought he had passed. But then he opened his eyes and said, oh, how long have you been here? Oh, I said, just a minute. And I was fine with it for 15 minutes. I had 15 minutes. If he had not woke up, it would have been a serene time. Okay. Because I wanted to say these were more for myself than for him. I wanted to draw more energy at the end from him. And yet, but he was very lucid. He was making lists. That's only he could make lists, the 3x5 cards, of all those things. By the way, Beth, only had to refer to those 3x5 cards one time. He only had to show me one time. Never had to look at them again. And he said, how's Pop, my father? I said, Pop's good. He's one in a million. You know how he is. 101, lived to be 110. We don't know. How's Amy? How's Kate? They're fine. Daughters, they're fine. We haven't told him anything. They go to pieces. And then he goes, boy, I'm really sorry to put you through this. I'm really sorry to put Judy through this. And he says, I'm really sorry to put that through this. I worry about that. Well, I wasn't going to let him do it. I said, you have to let go. I said, you can't worry about that. I couldn't let him. I told him what he was like. He should not ever have to apologize to anybody. I said, don't worry about Bev. And don't worry about yourself. Bev will be fine. Bev has loads of family, loads of friends. She'll be fine. And don't worry about yourself either. I said, you have to go. You have to. Whatever they're giving you, the morphine, take it, take a couple deep breaths, lean back, relax, close your eyes, deep breaths, and just ease on it. Ease on it. People are waiting for you. People are waiting for you. Well, I don't know if you heard me or not. It's hard to hear. Sad. But I think he knew. And I was saying it more for myself, drawing that energy. And I said, you know, you've been a great friend, but don't tell you that. Everybody tells you that. I said, but people are waiting for you. Yeah, move on. And it's hard to say that. I have to be very gentle, but it's just not my nature. Like, very reactionary. Very rough sometimes. But I couldn't do that. So he relaxed. And I said, you don't have a thing to worry about. When you pass, there'll be two people there. Richard. They'll grab a hold of you, take you to your brothers, to your friends, to your whole other life. You have so much to give in that life. You have to get home. I didn't care. Because I was saying to myself. But I think he knew. So I said, look, Russell, my father was one in a million. You're one in a million. And I said, take the big sleep. Take the big sleep. And I fist pumped him. He went downstairs and said, Judy. And afterward, I said, well, what did you say to Russell? I talked with Ben for 15, 20 minutes. And then Judy and I went on to run some errands. I said, well, what did you say to Russell? She said, he was such a wonderful friend, a friend to everyone. And I said the same thing. I said the same thing. That's how everybody gets him. That's what he is. So, there it is. But I'm haunted already. But I want to be haunted. I'm haunted by that kiss. I want him to be impressed. But I want him in this life too. So I want to be haunted. And that shall pass. Because he's in a better place. He's in a better life. He's having so much fun. And he's at rest. He's taking that big sleep. And he's waiting for us. He's waiting for them. He's waiting for everyone. Great man. He's at rest. But he's having so much fun. Because he's the greatest friend. He's a friend for all seasons. Now, I'm going to read you something. I'm not done. I told you. It would not be short, Judy. It would not be short. He came over to our house when we bought our house. We didn't even own it yet. And he's over there weeding. He's over there weeding. We don't know this, but that was his gift to us. He weeded for 3 or 4 days. This was about 8 years ago. And he said, I said, why did you do that? He said, I'm going to do it. You know, all this work that you draw energy from. And you give it back and you pay it back. And I said, well, how many weeds did you get? He said, about 125 pounds. 125 pounds? How do you know? Oh, it was really heavy. And I said, well, who did you get the help to lift that container up the truck? He says, no, I did that. So he would check our house. So this is what he would say, because I would leave things around the house for him to find. And he liked checking it, other than the time probably with the water pipe first. That's a whole other story where Bev, the queen, had to advocate for us with the insurance company because we were out of the country and Russell had all that on his plate and he didn't need that. But he would write notes, copious notes, very detailed notes about how the house was and the beauty of the place and all that. Very detailed oriented person. I appreciated that because I'm a very detailed oriented person. But he would leave notes and they were very nice notes. But then he would leave some notes for me. So now you're going to find out the real Russell Chapman, because I'm going to read some notes
of what he thought of me, because see, opposites attract. He's so very good, I'm so very bad. You are old. That's a good one, right? The church lady would say, that's very special. Happy birthday, you old fart. And then there's John Hancock, Mark. As you have aged, you have become less argumentative. You have mellowed. Boy, he got that right. What? For explanation, what? Another version of these ugly slippers. I would leave the map. I'd leave my underwear out here. I will say you are using every bit of this bar of soap. Judy is an angel, exclamation, in parentheses, putting up with you. I really don't know why she married me. I'm a hot mess. White hot mess. Hopefully, to be replaced soon. They happen. This is totally disgusting. Lee Hepner should not have to see this when he inspects the house. It's sickening. Not the house. Me, of course. Wonderful and attractive door stops. I think it was like a Nerf ball. This awful yellow bag of stuff, does that not need to be hidden? It's hiding the beauty of the riser to the staircase. Unnecessary. More on this. Number one, two, and three. The yellow bag on the staircase riser is totally unacceptable. See other note. One riser. Two, the doorstop is still ridiculous. And as soon as I find one that's appropriate doorstop in my antique visits, I will purchase one for you. See note. Three, the ugly slippers or whatever they are do not need to be on display for all to see as you enter whatever the bedroom might be. Didn't need to see this face every time I walked into the bedroom, so I turned it down. I don't know whose face that was. It was not. Take the big sleep closet. Rest in peace.
He talked for a long time. Who, I don't know who that was.
And next I would ask if Kevin, fellow sportsman, colleague, offer a few comments.
Couldn't have put me before Steve. Everyone forgive me, I'm going to have to read this, because I wouldn't, I don't have
that.
Speaking, so bear with me, please. First met Russell in 1980, October 1980 to be more exact, when I joined FNN Bank. After a year or so, I heard the executive management was interviewing for an experienced banker to manage his planned new sale office. After a few more months, I spoke to Russell about the job. Even though I didn't have the banking experience that they were looking for. After all, this new branch was to be FNM's first office outside of Cumberland County and very important for the bank's continued growth. I went to the job, though, and after several interviews, I was offered the job. Fast forward a few years, Russell humble as always, told me while we're on the fifth tee at Holly Hills, at the bank's annual Columbus Day Christmas, golf tournament, that he had recommended to executive management that they offered the job to me. It's possible to describe how much that single act of confidence positively influenced my career, my family, and me personally. We soon developed a friendship. In spite of our years of difference in age, but that friendship was kindled by our mutual love of sports and our jobs. As we and others at the bank worked together through the mountain of details that needed to be completed before the new Salem branch could be opened, I learned of his aversion to having any paper on his desk. He explained that he never handled a piece of paper more than once. He either took care of it himself or he delegated it to someone who would. I could walk into his office any time of day, any day of the work week, see his front desk void of even a post-it note, and ask him, "Did you just get here?" His glance at me, back at me, and his wry smile told me all I needed to know. Most days you would find him at his back desk working on the next payroll, feverishly punching the buttons on his 1940s era hand crank adding machine. Not a calculator, the old hand crank adding machines. You could hear that thing click, 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 clang all throughout the first floor of the bank.
Don't forget the colored markers.
Thank you, Rich. When completed, he would hand write payroll check stubs on every employee. When done, he hand counted paper money, all new bills, which he put into envelopes, together with the pay stub, and distribute those to the appropriate branch and department managers for a distribution to their respective staff, nearing 200 employees at that time. He is the most meticulous person I've ever known. To borrow a phrase from Bev, that's Russell. And as you all probably know, Russell detested technology and saw where it was taking us. The words technology and Russell Chappie, a senior at that time, could never be used in the same sentence. He eventually used a desktop computer, but didn't like it. But he does have a flip phone. In early 1983, he and I attended many classes at Philadelphia National Bank to learn how to manage the installation and integration of ATM machines into the bank's main office, the West Side office, Salem office, and Cumberland Mall office. Cutting edge stuff for F&M at that time. And of course, what's an ATM? Computer. Never keen on navigating Philly traffic, however, or any traffic for that matter, He asked if I would drive. 6 months worth of driving to Philly, a couple, 3 days a week. So we got the bond quite a bit during that time. So I certainly learned of his aversion to driving. And in the coming years, when we traveled to sports events, he asked if I would drive. King of Prussia, Cooperstown, Baltimore, Atlantic City, Fort Washington, Phillies games, and other places too numerous to remember, let alone name. Those adventures, however, were not without a few post-trip digs from Russell when he would recount our travels to others. He said my tailgating habit was so bad that if the passenger in the car in front of us was reading a newspaper, he wouldn't have to read his own paper when he got home later that day. And when we reached our destination, he pulled out that cell phone, called Bev, and told him that we had arrived. But I suspect he mostly called Bev to let her know that we arrived safely. I can say that I'm a better driver today because of Russell. Russell also kindled my interest in sports memorabilia. Sure, as kids, we all collected cards. But over the years, he didn't stop at just cards. As Bevan and their sons can really attest. And we all know his curator-like knowledge and his vast and diverse sports memorabilia collection. And again, other people have alluded to this. You could literally spend days in his sports room and not see it all. He is proud of it, eagerly offers anyone a tour. He's an expert on his favorite player, Richie Ashburn, his memorabilia, his career, his life. But he often spoke of his love items related to sports memorabilia, but he loved the more oddball sports items from the 50s and 60s, certainly going back to his childhood. These items were long forgotten and certainly dismissed by a lot of collectors, but he always displays a keen eye for quality, value, and scarcity of those items. And we all know Russell is a self-professed hoarder of all types of memorabilia and antiques. And I'm talking about vintage, classic Americana. An old barber's pole and chair, skee ball machine, albums and 45s, thousands of Santa Claus tree ornaments, as you all know, and scented knickknacks of all shapes and sizes. Sheet music, pinball machines, and on and on and on. He is the greatest picker I've ever known. Not satisfied with owning one Joe Namath endorsed popcorn topper. He has six of them. Ted Williams endorsed Sears bicycle. He has several of them. When I asked him why, he explained that as a kid growing up in Richmond's better days, there was no room in the very meager family budget for anything more than an occasional pack of cards. Russell opened so many opportunities for so many people to succeed in their careers and lives. He invited as many friends to join him at bank events and civic and personal events when he really didn't have to or need to, but we all know why he did. Always the uniter and never the divider, that was Russell. Russell speaks often and glowingly of his love and pride and admiration for his family. Most important thing in his life. Bev, Rusty, Scotty, in-laws, grandkids, brothers, nephews, and nieces. During our travels, phone calls, or visits to the house, before he started any conversation about his family, he always asked about mine. Russell's proud of his career at F&M Bank, tempered by the heartbreak of losing that career when the bank was sold in 2000. In my opinion, no one person in this world was more dedicated to F&M. He cares so much about the fate of the employees and not enough for his. During the last few months of F&M, he worked tirelessly in keeping employees in their jobs or to place them in other banks or local businesses. That was Russell. Always a professional, I never saw him react or speak negatively of how the sale of the bank was going to affect him and his family. But make no mistake, a heartbreaking, life-altering event it was. After 40 years of stellar service to F&M and its customers, he never received so much as a cursory interview to remain at the successor bank in any capacity. The only thing he asked for and got when he left that bank was that old hand crank batting machine. Russell was frequently asked by many grieving families that alluded to earlier, do you eulogize their lost loved one? What does that tell you? He always speaks eloquently, earnestly, and succinctly. When I ever heard him deliver a eulogy or a birthday speech, or when introducing an inductee at the All Sports Museum, or his speech at a small Christmas gathering, wherever and whenever he spoke, people listened intently. On the edge of your seat, listen. The old TV commercial, E.F. Hutton, listen. You don't remember that one, then Google it in honor of Russell. E.F. Hutton. It is impossible and not fair to use these few words to describe or recall his extraordinary life. They don't do him or his family justice. A million words wouldn't be enough. We are all fortunate for Russell's life, his love, his leadership, his friendship, his generosity. It is said during your life you are lucky to have a few good friends and one or two very close friends. Russell is that one very close friend. Who stands with you and by you with a timely, encouraging word and deed. Without judgment or expectation of anything in return, just like what your family would do. We'll meet again, my very close friend. We love you and your family. And most of my memories here today are in the present tense, because you're with us now and always. But it's time now for you to rest your body and your mind at peace.
And last but not least of our sharers today is son Russ Jr.
Let not your heart be troubled. I am the last speaker. So I stand here today to deliver a eulogy for the undisputed king of eulogies, as you heard. He kept all his eulogies and he has them in a little drawer, which we can go back and look at all the different words that he shared with people. What's the consistent theme in all of that writing is he spoke directly from his heart. Everything he did in his life was directly from his heart. Whether it was a kind deed, a thoughtful expression of gratitude, or just a simple congratulations, it came directly from here. There was nothing superficial about it whatsoever. You would think, me being his firstborn son, I have some kind of different view of my father, unique from yours, something that no one knows. And the beauty of my father is, he was the exact same man at home as he was in the bank, as he was on the softball field, as he was with the grandkids. No matter who he was, or who was with, he was the exact same person. Now, how many people can say that? Since the time I was old enough to realize I wanted to be like my dad, I never looked at either of my parents as being uncool. They were always the cool parents. So I'll try to do exactly what my dad did today and just speak directly from here. My dad was born into a very poor family. They had a very little when he was born. He had older parents for the time, and he was born right at the start of World War II. My father did not have indoor plumbing until he was in high school. It was baths at the kitchen sink and an outhouse. He didn't have a television until he was older. Food was stretched at times by his beloved mother. And he would share stories of growing up, just a little drips and drabs. One day, me and Scotty were kids and we're all having strawberry shortcake. And he said, you know, sometimes that's all I had for dinner was strawberry shortcake. But it wasn't a complaint, because he would tag on, but my mom's was the best. The house was short of money, but it was filled with love. It was filled with gratitude. It was filled with joy. Because all of his childhood stories, whether it's with some of his great childhood friends, whether it's with his high school friends, they're always told with joy. It's a well-documented and often told tale of how my mother does not bake. In fact, she doesn't care much for cooking. For many years, she had the three ingredient rule. If it had more than three ingredients, she wasn't making. The famous story of how this sort of all occurred was when they were first married and my mom decided to bake her husband some delicious chocolate chip cookies. And of course she baked them with pride and probably never made them before. And so he's trying them and she says, well, how are they? He said, well, they're great, but they're not as good as my mom's. My dad was never baked chocolate chip cookies by my mother ever again. I'm not even sure we had cookie trays in the house. This is why my wife Debbie, when she makes his favorite chocolate mayonnaise cake, takes great pride when he says, why, this is just like my mom's. And he loved his family. And he only looked back at those times of him growing up with love. Because of the love of his friends and the kindness he showed with his co-workers, with his teammates, our house was always filled with baked goods. Doc Riley brownies, Lois Lawrence cupcakes, or whatever her latest baking adventure was. And a disclaimer, my mom really was a good cook. We give her a hard time, but we had good meals. My dad loved sports, you've heard. He played golf, had so many great golf trips with so many great buddies. He played in so many different leagues of softball, basketball. F&M Bank was by far the glory years of his life. That was the fast pitch league. As a kid, being a bat boy, or just sitting in the stands and watching these guys play, it's the most exciting thrill I've ever had in my life. Seeing my dad play with these guys. And the games were great, and they were phenomenal athletes, because you could not play fast pitch softball in Princeton, New Jersey, and not be a good athlete. So Bobby Zimmerman, Uri Morris, Buck Phillips, Randy Winchester, these are the guys that were my family. They were my family. They weren't just the guys on my dad's team. They were my family. He loved playing ball. He loved them. It's said how you play the game shows your true character. My dad showed a ton because he was always a gentleman. Don't get me wrong. He wasn't nice on the field. He wanted to beat you. Judy Poloff shared a story with me earlier how they were playing bocce on the beach. And she made a good shot playing bocce. And my dad congratulated him. And she said, he made me feel so good. And then he threw his next ball and knocked my ball right out of the way. And he goes, well, you still have to win, Judy. And she said she didn't feel bad about it. I watched him play ball for many years. I watched him make game-saving catches, robbing home runs by jumping over the fence long before Mike Trout did it. I saw him crash through fences. The famous basketball story is I drove 13-year-old me, drove my dad's El Camino home because they gave him a shot of something and he had no idea where he was because my mother didn't want to want Miss Roots on television. 13. I never drove before. When kids at school used to write their reports on their heroes, Mike Schmidt, Terry Bradshaw back in that time, Dr. J, I would always write mine about my dad. He was bigger than life like any of those professional athletes. He was a true sportsman on or off the field. He loved games on the beach, horseshoes with his brothers, anything with hand-eye coordination, he was awesome. He loved sitting at the grand table with his grandkids, playing Rummy Cube or Racco, and he was trying to win. It was always followed, though, by a custom-made ice cream sundae. Mm-hmm. And more than a few of you have had one in here. It's calculated that your chance of being born and even having a life is 400 trillion to one. Can you imagine that? It is not lost on my brother and I that when it came to being born to the parents that we were given, that we hit the lottery twice. The example that my dad set for us and continues to set for us is mind-boggling. It seems he just did everything right. He was never deeply religious. We did not go to church. But he is the most Christian man I have ever known in his actions, in his words, in his deeds, in his generosity, in his treatment of other people. And that's whether it was someone he knew as a longtime friend or a stranger on the street. My parents, as I said, were cool. They listened to our music. We listened to the same music. My dad had a record collection, as Kevin mentioned, downstairs. And I'd bring my friends over, and he had this beautiful album case with all his albums displayed. And my friends would go, oh, you got the new Van Halen album? And I said, no, that's my dad. My records are up in my room. My parents had two drummers and two drum sets in the house at one time, and they never complained. My dad loved music. He loved hearing it. He always tried to play an instrument, never really succeeded, but was thrilled when my brother and I started playing music. I don't think he ever imagined that instead of an athletic field, he'd be going to a theater to watch plays, which he expressed to us many times. Especially with the grandkids, he was especially proud of all their programs and music and things that they did. In theater, he beamed with pride as a proud dad. And he lived his life based on the things that he loved, the simple pleasures in his life, a meal, a game, a kind handwritten note. He never missed a moment. He found solace in his collecting, as also so many people have mentioned. And he had so many great friends who he met through the different worlds that he dabbled in. Athletic field, sports collecting, South Jersey Hall of Fame, the bank. And you can see from the different people that came up and spoke how he touched each and every group of those people. There's a million things that he taught me. And as attested to before, I could go for days and days telling you all the different ways and different moments and different things he has, but two always come to my mind, two specific things come to my mind. One was when my brother and I were younger, and we would go at it a little bit. And looking back, in today's world, what we did was tame. Well, we were angels. But we would have disagreements, little squabbles. My parenting was a good cop, bad cop relationship. Mom was the bad cop. Dad was the good cop. Mom was emotional, firm, unwavering. My father was like a cool Mr. Rogers that would say, oh, you're making your mother upset. Get along with your brother. It's just going to make everything better for everybody. But one particular day, because my brother and I could hear everything going on because of my mother's shrill voice at that time, everything going on downstairs, she said, as my dad was coming home from work or a game or something, me and my brother were sent to our room.
You could listen at the vents. You could hear it.
That's right. That's right. Because she never said, wait until your father gets home. She handled it herself. So this was something different. So she sent us upstairs, and I heard her saying to my father, Russell? She had the belt. Oh, that's the other thing. Now, I was not beaten or abused in any way as a child. This is just the life that it was in 1977. So there was 1970s wide belts that she would do this motion with. That was the threatening part. She very rarely smacks. But it was that. Anyway, she hands the belt to my dad as he's walking in the door, and she said, Russell, I want you to go upstairs and beat your sons. Now, do you remember Dad ever touching us at all? I don't think he did. So he comes to my room first, being the oldest. Sullen expression, almost pale. Holding limply the belt, walking over to me on my bed, and he said in that Mr. Rogers kind of, Russell, you gotta get along with your brother, it upsets your mom, now she sent me up here to do this. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna hit the bed, and you scream. Russell, I told you! Did the same thing when my brother's room did the same thing. I'm sure, strutting down the stairs, handed the belt to my mother and said, anything else you need me to take care of? Just that kind of compassion, just that kind of kindness. I never wanted to disappoint my father. I never wanted to get him mad at me or make him disappointed in me. The second thing that comes to mind is just about a year ago, very weak. He loved to come hear our band play. Him and my mom would be sitting at some dive bar, the oldest people in the room. All the 20 and 30 year olds would love them and loved them because they were sitting over in the corner. They usually get them little chairs, but they loved to go to stakeouts because they had food. They ordered food. They were sitting right over on the side, but there was a song that our band did. It was a U2 song, Where the Streets Have No Name. I happened to sing that one. And for some reason, and I don't know why, but my dad really loved that song. He loved that song. It wasn't necessarily because I was singing it, I don't think. It was because I think he loved the song anyway. So every time we would do that song, wherever he was sitting, because they usually sat and he usually had to sit because he was weak, he'd get up and he'd walk over. He'd stand right in front of the band. And I always asked him, Dad, why do you get up every time we play that song? He goes, because I really love that song. I love the way you guys do it. I don't want anybody talking to me while you're single. So on this particular time at stakeouts, for most of the event, he was leaning on my mom's shoulder because he was so weak. And we started playing that song.
And he got up off the chair and he stood right in front of the band. And he leaned against the post, but he was not missing his spot up front to hear that song. Yeah, imagine me trying to sing that song. I'm looking at my dad, knowing what he went through, an infusion the day before, knowing that he was just sitting there. But the only thing I could think of was, how blessed am I that somebody could love me that much, could be that proud of me, could be that interested or care about me that much, that they could take that much pain to do a simple little thing. But it was monumental. And then I realized, he did that for everybody. He made everybody feel that way. That was the magic that he had. He had the ability to make everyone feel like they were the most important thing at the time in that moment. Now, it may seem that that's the thing that we lost, but it's not. That's the thing that we can carry on to keep him alive. He might be gone from this physical world, but we can keep that world alive by how we treat other people, how we love the people in our lives, how we express the gratitude, how we give everything we have to the people in our lives. So I hope that you all will try that in honor of my dad, to love the people that you love and be kind to everyone else, no matter what. I love you, Dad.
Thank you, Russ. So we all know that Russell liked a good eulogy. He sure got his fair share of them today, no doubt. Thanks to all of you who shared one final song, which will be sung in tribute to their grandfather, Francesca and Melina. If you'd come forward, please, and offer us the final song.
To dream the impossible dream, to fight the unbeatable foe, to bear with unbearable sorrow, to run where the brave dare not go, to right the unrightful wrong, to love pure and chaste from afar, to join the ardent to rear, to reach the unreachable star. This is my quest, to follow that star, no matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And I know if I'll only be true to this glorious quest, on my heart will my peace fully calm when I lay to my rest. And the world will be better for this. That one man, scorned and covered with scars, still strove with his last ounce of courage to reach the unreachable star. This is my
He did love to see you perform. Many times I witnessed that at Hopewell School in your younger days. So, a grandfather of pride, a husband of love, a father of example, all those things that Russell has been to us. And in just a few moments, we're going to travel by procession to Overlook Cemetery, where there will be a final prayer, and he will be laid to rest.